As you start speaking. Thank you very much, Sten, for starting the record. So indeed, this webinar will be recorded. All mutes are online. If you have a question, I will be monitoring the questions and asking questions and answers section, and I will kindly or see if I can interrupt Danny and Wim with your questions. Otherwise, we will take the questions offsite and get back to you to formulate some answers. That's it. Danny and Wim, you are on mute. So if you want to unmute yourself, I will stop sharing and you can take over the screen.
Thank you, Carl. I think that we will start with the first part.
Yes, I will start. Let me share the screen. Taking a few seconds.
We can see the screen, but it's not in presentation mode yet.
Yeah, I know.
We got it.
Coming. It's going to be fixed. Oh. Now we're there. Yeah. Yeah. Thanks, Carl, for organizing this event. My name is Wim Horsling. I'm a channel manager for networking for example, Belgium. And together with Danny Krieger, we will entertain you today. First, I think it's good to start with the main objective we have as Dell Networking, and that is to solve the challenges of scale and complexity by giving up human control and rely on software to run the systems. So what we're trying to do is to provide networking solutions by designing, configuring, and setting them up by using software. Before we go in that, I think it's good that we observe a bit the history. And for that, I share you with you this slide where we briefly remember you that in the past there was mainframe computing with circuit switching, dial-up access, and that evolved into server computing and cloud computing, and now SDN, SD-WAN, 5G. This also had an impact on the employees setting up and deploying these IT environments. So in the past, we had mainframe computing, where there was the mainframe admin, the PBX admin with dumb terminals. That evolved into the storage admin, and obviously, for example, most important, the network admin. But this has now sort of evolved or is seeing the completion of being evolved into a cloud admin, an infrastructure admin, and a new role, the virtualization admin. And we see, we know this trend, or we quite often name this software-defined networking. Now, some of you might think, well, now it's all going to be virtualized and now it's all going to be in the cloud. So the cloud is going to solve it all. So isn't it? So therefore, I would like to, let's say, do a fresh up to everybody that nowadays an end user has actually signed up to four different public cloud providers, and he has also on top of that a private cloud or a private data center. the private cloud might be something he hires or he uses as a service from you as a reseller. So many partners, many integrators offer private cloud services to their customers. Why do customers have multiple cloud environments? Because there is the law of physics. Is it physically possible to place a workload or place data somewhere in that particular cloud? There are the laws of the land. So is it legally possible or is it legally allowed to place data or workload on that particular public cloud, because it might be outside Belgium, for example? That is the law of economics. What is the most financially interesting, financially appealing offer of that particular cloud provider? And there are the laws of change. So it's nice to put your data, to put your workload on a particular public cloud provider, but the circumstances might change. So you might want to reallocate your data, your workload. So that means that most customers have gone into a model like this, where they have the public cloud, let's say, as a flexible capacity, and they have the private cloud, the private data center, as a baseline capacity. So this is usually the setup that we find. However, this baseline capacity might still be a problem. So this private cloud. So we did in early January, or in January, we did with a Dutch reseller, we did a roundtable with 10 end users. And two of the 10 end users stated that they try to do network automation in their private cloud, in their private data center, and it did not bring what they were expecting. So that sort of pushed them into, let's say, even going more into the public cloud. But this seminar is about how do you grow with networking, how do you grow as a partner. And in that way, we as Dell help you with more automation into the private data center. So your private cloud, we have technologies like Smart Fabric Services, Fabric Design Center, Smart Fabric Director as technologies. So that's where we help you to bring a higher degree of automation in your data center to stack up against the cloud. We also help you in your office building, so your campus site with Workspace ONE, with campus switching. And more important, also important, is that we help you with wide area technologies as they want to interconnect all your cloud environments. And that concludes the end of my presentation. Thank you.
So in that case, I will take it over. Welcome everybody. Good afternoon. My name is Danny Krieger. I'm the pre-sales sales engineer networking for Belgium and Luxembourg. I'm the technical brains or the technical resources for the salespeople, but also for Tech Data when there are any questions about networking. What I would like to talk about is where Wim was just finished by the automation. In this case, automation in the data center. And when I'm talking about data center, it doesn't mean it's a data center like that Proximus has, or that Telenet has, or the big ones. It's also a data center within the customers itself. So based on two switches and some of the servers, or two switches, servers, and some storage. So it's really depending on not how big it is, but more based on what's going to happen or what can I do with the automation itself. So I would like to talk about more about the Smart Fabric services as a solution that is built in. Smart Fabric services is a component of the Smart Fabric OS X version that is on our switches. But it's also integrated within the VX wheel, but it's also integrated in the standard Power Edge, also integrated in the Power Store. So it's more than only based on the switches. It will be a smart, that's where it is from, a smart collaboration within all the solution. So in this case, when we're talking about the VX wheel, yes, you can see from out of the VX wheel, or most likely from out of the vCenter, you can see also the switches. It's not only the virtual switches that is based in the VMware itself. No, it's also the hardware that is based on, in this case, the top of rack. And it's also including for the PowerEdge servers and also for the vCen ready nodes, but also for the PowerScale and the PowerStore environment. When I'm talking about the total solution, I think it's more based on the in what can we do, or thinking about a pluggable infrastructure vision. So all the items that we have, I think it's all down there, from SDS to hyperconverged infrastructure, PowerEdge, the storage, even converged, and also some of the third-party devices in there. You have the switches, but on top of that, I think you have more the management tools that is based on the VMware. So thinking about vCenter or OpenManage or PowerOne, all those items. And when you have a plugin in that system, in this case, is that called OMNI or Open Manager Network Integration, then you have a connection to our switches. And with that, you can control them in vCenter. So you don't have to connect or to make it happen in the switches itself. So when I'm talking about that one, it is more based on the, thinking about how many lines that you can need to provide it. So it is more complex, it's manual, and it's also error prone. That means that you have to configure all those items per switch. So if you have, for example, a VX wheel, or you have a Power Edge, or you have a PowerStore server running there, and then you need a switch on top of it to make the connections to the network itself, you need to configure all those lines. And it is more than 500 per switch. That is something that you need to do manual. But if you can do it already based on a sort of automation, and that automation can help you more in depth, it is just easy. So only 89% of the task that you should do is already been done. So it's centralized. It will be simple and it will be automated. And the most part of it, it's a total Dell solution. In cooperation with VMware, we can have the total solution within vCenter. And that means that you can control it from out of vCenter. And that is the beauty part of what we can do. So instead of that, you put in 500 lines per switch, and even it's just two switches, there are still 1,000 lines that you need to put in. Or when you have four switches or six switches, then you can multiply it by that number. In that case, it will be more agile, reliable, and it's future-proof. And that is something where we can help you for our total solution. If we're looking at the total connection, and if you have multiple from that part, but even the multiple parts will be not most likely, but I think it's based on the VX will on the Power Edge, EXI, or the Power Store, or the Power Skill. And then you will have the deployment agility. And of course, it's automated. So how it's looking like, and what is it happened, and what can I do for that part? It's more based on the total solution that you can run on it. Looking at the there it is, unified solution. It's more based on the second day of the environment. So it's a zero touch deployment, and the zero touch, yes, that's the 2% that you need to put in. You need to have an IP address on the switches, and with that you can make the connection to your vCenter. And from out of your vCenter, you can control, you can configure, but also deploy the total VMs on your servers, but also based on your switches, and making the connection to your external network or to your internal network, or based on another vendor network. So that is not the issue. It's just making it more exciting for you as a admin. Lifecycle management is one of the part of that. And with the lifecycle management, you can also control the operating system that is existing on the switch. If it's not there, or of course it's there, otherwise it doesn't work. But if you would like to replace a new or the oldest one with a new version, it's going to be done from out of the vCenter. And that's the most beautiful part of it. You can control it by every switch which is in your Smart Fabric. So the Smart Fabric services is supported by our S-series switches. So those switches who are responsible, or we are dedicated within the data center itself. Which switches are that? Well, I think we have some of the hardware. I will start first on the edge, so more based on the campus side, and making it up to the total environment. When you're looking from the left to the right, we're starting with the N1100 and up till to the enterprise spine with the Z series. This is our portfolio. Is this enough? Yes, this is what you need. This is what you need within a data center. Especially when you're looking at the data center itself, then the enterprise leaf and the enterprise spine, those are the switches which are you gonna use for in the data center. Some of the people, they say, oh yes, but I'm using the N series also in the data center. Is it working? Yes, is it working? Is it gonna offer me the specialties that I have for my power, store, or for my storage in total, for my iSCSI environment? No. Is it working? Yes. Is it supported? No. But that doesn't mean that you need to go for another part. It's just making it really happen on that soon. Let's see. When I'm looking at the campus environment, what we have today is the N1500, the N2200, and the N3200. What is the main difference in these three family lines? Well, I think we will start at the bottom. Well, the bottom is not the right part, but we will start with the lowest entry, and that is the N1500. We are talking about the Broadcom chipset that we are using, and you can see that it's almost in everybody, in every switch that we have. But it is more likely based on what are the features. The features like layer 2, layer 3, or can I make a stack? And how big is the stack? Well, in this case, for the N1500, you can have a stack up to 4 switches. If you need more within the stack, then you need to go to the N2200. You can build them up to 12 switches. And same for the N3200, it's also for 12 switches. But then you have a different speed. The N1500 is just a switch who can deliver up to 1 gig. So it's 10 MB, 100 MB, or 1 gig for the ports for the user. The uplinks, it's up to 10 gig. When you're looking at the N2200 and the N3200, those are different. because then we're talking about more that the switches are a multi-speed switch. And with multi-speed switch, it's not only that we can deliver 10, 100, and 1 gig. No, in this case, you can deliver on the N2200 also 2.5 gig. Why 2.5 gig, you're going to ask? Well, with the new standard, the new wireless standard, the AX standard, you can have multiple lines, but also one line for 2.5 gig connections to your access port. And the same for the N3200 series. There is also a multi-speed switch, but you can deliver on that switch up to 10 gig. So you have 10, 100, 1 gig, 2.5 gig, 5 gig, and 10 gig ports. Why is it important? Well, I think it's more important for the IoT devices that we will have in the nearby future today, looking at cameras, access points, and stuff like that. And the most important part is that both the families, the N2200 and the N3200, can deliver more than 30 watt per port. In this case, the N2200 can deliver up to 60 watts per port. The N3200 can deliver up to 90 watt per port. So that is something what is needed within the standard environment. No, but maybe in the nearby future, when we have the laptops who can power it up by power over Ethernet, maybe. Then you can have a switch and you can deliver directly on your network port in the switch where you can deliver or you can get the right port environment. All the times that we have here, well, I think we have some of the items that it's there. And even when we're looking a little bit further on the other features, software features, you can see that the N1500 is a layer 3 light. Then you have a layer 3 standard, and then you have the layer 3 advanced. And you see that in all the parts, there will be more yeses than no on that part. The N1500, only static and RIP. Looking at the N2200, then you have also OSPF. Looking at the layer 3, for the N3200, you can have already BGP or VRFs. So it's really more and more important on what kind of switches that you need and what kind of type that you would like to have. For the data center, the enterprise data center hardware, we have the families of the S4100, the S5200, and the Z series. And those three are the most important switches within the data center. Why? Well, I think you can use the S4100 switch. You can use it also as a campus environment for the core switch. So connecting all the N series up to the S4100 series or to the S5200 series, because the N3200 and the N2200 series, they have uplink ports up for 25 gig. S4100 switch is a 10 gig data center switch or a core switch. The S5200 is a 25 gig switch port, but also some modules, they can have already 100 gig for the uplinks or just for the port itself. And the Z series, those are the big monsters in the data center who can deliver up to 400 gig per port. Is that for a standard environment with a standard customer in Belgium? No, but we have it. And sometimes some of the universities, they would like to see if it's happened or what they can do with 100 gig between two switches, or when they have 3 or 4 data center connections, can then connect more and more on that part? So yes, that will be very important. All those switches that we have working on the open networking. And based on open networking, well, let me explain first what is open networking, because sometimes we have a discussion or I have a conversation with one of the end users or the customers itself, and they ask me, what is open networking? Because everybody's talking about open networking and everybody's talking about software-defined networking. What is the difference? Well, I think that the difference is on the hardware and the software itself. So in this case, open networking is a separation of the hardware and the software. So in a ordinary words, we're talking about white label with some software. You can buy that both in China or in Taiwan. But in this case, what we have as Dell, we don't have white labels, but we have bright labels. And bright means that we have thinking about it because you need also some support. And when you are doing white label, you don't have any support. So in this case, you can have a choice of what kind of box that you need. So for example, the S4100 series, and what kind of OS do you need? Do you need OS 10? Do you need OS 9? Or do you need Sonic or Prolibus? So those are the difference what we can do with the open networking. But what is then software defined? Well, software defined is that we can separate the control plane from the physical switch. So the control plane is the information that we have when we make the configuration on the switch itself. In this case, we rip out it and we put it on an external device. And from out of the external device, we can control and configure those switches in a total environment. So in this case, for example, when you're looking at the spine leaf environment within a smart fabric services, then we do there more a smart software-defined networking because we can control it from out of the vCenter. So the vCenter is the centralized control, but I can still control or configure our switches it by CLI. So it's a hybrid solution in this case. So when we're looking at the open networking total, then we have a framework, as what we called. The framework is more based on what would like the people like to do. We like they have a fully control switch already done. So then it will be OS 10 with the smart fabric. Or they would like to have an open networking stack. So then we use Prolibus, for example. Or you would like to have a more disaggregated environment. In that case, you would like to go for Sonic or for the OS 10 Enterprise Edition, the Open Edition. With that, then you need to configure more on the internal side than you do it by an external environment. The other part is when we're looking at the open SDN framework, then we have the Smart Fabric OS 10, but then with the Smart Fabric services, or you have the Sonic, and then it's a controlled by Apstra. That is an external platform that you can use for the configuration, but also the interlink with the NSXT or with VMware itself. How bigger or how complexer you will be, it's easier to do on that part. In total, when you're looking at the evolution in total, we have started already for many years with a traditional network. So we had an hardware and the hardware itself. And then we have the OS that's on top of the hardware. But when you're looking at the open networking, then we still have the hardware, but then we have the open choice of a network OS, what we call the disaggregation of the hardware and the OS. Today, we're already in the next phase, and then we call it open source networking. And with open source networking, I think that most of you maybe heard it, it's Sonic. Sonic is a open source, and everybody can use it. But what we did, we give it an Dell source on top of it. So we have a Dell Enterprise Sonic. It's still Sonic, but we have putting on some extra features that we can use. Is that something that the Sonic from Microsoft already has embraced, or the Sonic from Cisco, or the Sonic from Juniper? No, they are just using the Sonic by themselves. And even those, they are not supported on all the switches. And we try to make it more open that we can control it or can help it on our total switches. So when we're looking at the life cycle from the SONIC part, well, I think that we make it more happen within the design. And Wim was already mentioning it. We have the smart fabric services. We have smart fabric director. And we have the design or the fabric design center. And you start with the design center itself. With the design center, you can have a configuration on the switches. And with that switches or with that configuration, you get a bill of material, but you can have also already a configuration in an Ansible environment or a clear text. And then you will go to the second phase, the deploy, and then go to the configuration where you can use your Ansible that you have built up or that you built already in your fabric design center. You have it already in place within the configuring situation in the phase. So that's the Ansible file. And then within operate, well, I think that you can use already with the Linux environments, the syslogs, the SNMP, all the items that you have there. And then of course, within the monitoring, because you would like to see what's happening on your network itself. But this is a choice. And a choice is that for a lot of companies, okay, do I need to go for SONIC or do I need to go for just the OS10? It really depends on how big is your environment? What are you going to do with your environment? What is the purpose that you would like to have for your servers and your storage? Are you a provider? Are you a data center? So that's really what's going to happen on that part. So there is also already an integration for the SONIC part. Thinking about Ansible, Apstra, Okatera, all those items are already available. Those are the items that are available on GitHub. And that's why something making it just more better and better, because for our OS X, you can have also already Ansible in place. When you're looking at the community, which in for Dell EMC, the enterprise, it's not only for the enterprise SONIC, but it's also for OS X, where you can have the Ansible available. The Smart Fabric Director, I already mentioned it a little bit more, but I think it's there. And Smart Fabric Director, it's more intent-based. And with intent-based is something that you would like to hear more about. You don't know what to do, but you would like to see what's happened. And that is something what intent-based networking will be there. And for those platforms or for those environments where you have NSXT in place, then the Smart Fabric Director will be an helpful hand to help you on that part. You're creating VMware physical environments, but also the other items that are there. So in this case, when we're talking about the environment of automation, and I think that in total, the automation will be a benefit for the people who are working with the servers and storage, but also for the switch itself. Because you need, or some of them, they have multiple projects under their overview, but they don't have any time. And with the automation, you can have more time. So it is easier to maintain, it's easier to roll out, it's easier to all the items that I already mentioned before. Just to remark, the items or what is the benefits, they are on the right side. To reduce the OPEX, that improves your lifecycle management. It has an agile, so it's more robust. It is error prone, so less errors, because the manuals that you would like to use on your CLI is something that you can forget. Don't forget, you still need to have knowledge about networking. you still need to know what a VLAN is, or you still need to know what spanning tree is, or you still need to know how to use an IP addresses between VLANs. So all those items together, I think that automation will be very useful for all the people, small to big. And even if it's just 2 switches or it's just 16 racks, doesn't matter. Automation will be the future of today. With that, I think will be ended.
Very well. Thank you very much, Danny. Thank you very much, Ben. I don't have questions. I'm not sure if there are questions in the audience. If so,
Very, very clear on what we mean. Or...
Yeah, also possible. Yeah. If you don't mind, I would like to share one last slide.
Of course.
Because here. Voilà. Hang on. Do we have Dell networking in Demo Center? I do have a question.
Ah, yes. So Tom. Yes, we have we have in the Demo Center, and what I can show you if that is something that some people would like to see, I can demo some of the I can have a small demo on the smart fabric services if there is any thought about it. And otherwise what I have is the demo center itself, and I can show you that we have a lot of networking.
Is there something you would like to do now?
If you are finished with that one, I will take over.
Yeah. Okay, good. In the meantime, let me share my screen again, because I would like to invite you for our next session, which is next week on Tuesday. And during this session, it will be more or less an introduction of a new SaaS platform for data protection from the edge, the core, to the cloud. So it's a new offering from Dell EMC Power Protect Backup Services. If you do not have an invitation for this, normally you should have, because the two webinars were linked together, the one for today and the one for next week. But if you do not have the invitation and would like to join or forward to one of your colleagues, do not hesitate to send a mail at dellemc@techdata.be. So let me go back to Danny.
Okay. Now you're too quick, all. Come on. Okay. Well, first of all, I would like to. Why is it not there? Okay. Then I would like to share my screen once again. That one, share. No, go away. Go away.
Yep, we have it.
So in this case, this part is from the demo center. But in this case, I have it put it on my laptop itself. This is an interactive demo. When you're having the demo on the demo center itself, then you can have more visibility, and you need to put in all the items that you would like to do. So in this case, what I just would like to share with you is just a 2% of the 100% where I'm talking about is to configure it. And in this case, we have a lot of switches in YSO, but if you're looking at only on 2 switches for NVXWheel, for example, so the S4112, for example, and you have here down here, you have some of the 4 nodes of VXWheel, then I need to configure it. And in this case, I will configure it in a quicker way. I have multiple lines in this case. I log in, making it all happen. What's there? I show you that there is no VLANs at this moment visible. And with that, it's also, there is no IP addresses for that, no BGP. Smart Fabric Services is based on, you can choose, or you have it on a layer 2 or a layer 3. So in this case, I would like to configure what I'm going to do. I make 4 switches. I'm giving them the role of a leaf. And I say on which part my VLT. And my VLT is the interlink between 2 of the switches. When I say that it's a layer 2 fabric, then it's just a layer 2, and then don't going to use a layer 3 environment itself. What I need to do is to reload it, because then I go into the vision of the switch that it's being placed in a smart fabric, and same I do for the spine. In this case, because I have 6 switches in that part, and then I have it already there. It's all done. It's all configured. Then I can show you that I have some VLANs already placed there. And there is really, I don't have to do anything on that part. Even when I'm looking at the IP addresses, it's there. It's based on what's inside. But I think what we would like to show you is the Smart Fabric instance within the VMware vCenter. I'm logging in. What I have to do is making happen that the Open Manager Network Integration, which is a special OVA, so I need to run it on a VM in this case, and I can plug it in within my vCenter. When I'm doing that, I have the capability to create an instance. In this case, the instance will be based on the switches that I just put in the Smart Fabric environment. In that case, the Fabric 2. So you will see a layout within vCenter. Down you will see that you have the Smart Fabric environment. You can upgrade the OS. You can replace the switches. That's still there. But also, when I'm looking at the topology, I can see I have already the switches inside. So for the people who know to work with vCenter, then it's easy for them also to configure those switches. And that is the beauty part of it. The beauty part will be, for example, making a layer 2 connection to a switch that's already internal the environment itself. So I would like to show you that there is no uplink just there. There is no links available. In this case, I will go to vCenter. And when I'm logging in vCenter, I will go to my second part of the Open Manager Network Integration, to my Fabric topology. I don't have a second switch, or I don't have a switch here internal. So I will go to manage that, and I will enter or build up a uplink. In this case, a layer 2 uplink, an uplink from to the data center or to one of the switches, just mention a name. Which rack I'm going to use. In this case, I would like to use the switches that are on the left side, that's in rack 1. I'm going to use link aggregation control protocol, or I can use static, it just depends on what you would like to have. The switch would like to use some of the ports. In this case, I would like to use port 10 because the cable is already there. That's something that I have put in already when I'm rack and stacked it. And then I go further, going there, making the VLANs that I use for that one. So the untagged, so that is mean that it's the PVID or the preferred VLAN ID that's going to be there. But also I can have for the network selection, which of the VLANs there are used to be tagged on that part. If there is another VLAN that is going to be built already in my vCenter, I would like to have automatically that's going to on that link. So yes, I would like to do that. In this case, it's done. And with done, it's really done, because when I just enter it, it's going to configure it totally directly. And as you can see, this is the uplink switch. These are the ports. And when I'm going to my environment for the switch itself, I would like to enter the same congregation. So you can see already that there's a lot of information there where we're talking about from, there are the links that are going up. In this case, I'm going to check, are the uplinks there? Yes, they're there. And that's easy. So for the people who are going to work with vCenter, it's easier for them also to configure the switches from Dell. Is this possible with another vendor? Sorry. In this case, not on this weather. And I would like to go for my, where is my demo center? Why is doesn't work? Okay. Always cool. Africa, Brussels, and city. That's strange. First time that I see this. Normally they would like to, yes. When you enter, even when you're just a partner, you have the capability for networking. And within networking, you have a lot of items that you would like to have. Based on OS10, OS10, just a hands-on, advanced, Ansible, but even for the smart fabric, you have the capability for the smart fabric services, the introduction, the advanced smart fabric director, second version that we have already. And then we have this is the interactive demo that I just showed to you. Sonic, even that's capable on that part, you can still have the other one. And then we have also some VeloCloud, which is SD1. So yes, we have a lot of items within the demo center. Other questions?
There's another question in the chat box. Do you see this chat box? Question, yes. And answers. Yeah. Yeah.
Is smart fabric still useful when using NSX? Yes, there is also an integration with NSX from our smart fabric services. Smart fabric services, NSX and vCenter, those three items, they are working closely together. So when you're using NSX, yes, I think even then you still have vCenter, and then you still need to configure your switches. And that is very useful. When you're using the NSXT version, and NSXT version is different than NSX itself, then you need to go for the Smart Fabric Director instead of the Smart Fabric Services. But that is because it's a different approach on how to configure from out of NSXT to your switches itself. And we don't, we cannot configure the NSXT environment or the NSX, no, that's still based on what's there, but we can have control and configure the switches from out of NSX and vCenter. I hope that was...
Maybe we can do a separate session for this particular interest. Yeah. It's maybe better, yeah. If Carl gathers the name of who the question was, then we can follow up.
Yeah, we have Wim. Yeah.
Okay.
Any other question? No.
Okay.
Cool. Thank you very much to the audience. Thank you very much to the speakers. I think it was meaningful. And for Wim, let's say that we will get in touch with you and see if we need to organize something specific to go more to in detail.
Yes.
Thank you very much, everybody.
You're welcome.
Oh, I have an open question from Tom. Yeah.
Tom.
Thank you very much.
Thanks, Tom.
Okay. Bye.
See you all. Bye-bye.